Hi, welcome. Thanks for coming. I'm C. Todd. I work over in the innovation loft, not lab. This is the lab. That's the loft, I guess, in Waltham. Circuitous route to got there. Happy to talk more about how I got there afterwards, if there's anyone who wants to chat one-on-one. But we've got a whole thing similar to here. We have some startups coming in. We have a bunch of programming. It's kind of cool. So I'll tell you more about that later. So enough talk. Anybody here know how to ice skate? All right. How did you learn how to ice skate? What? Falling a lot. That means you actually did it. You tried it, right? You didn't sit in a classroom listening to somebody talk about ice skating or roller skating, right? So that's what we're going to do here. We're going to learn how to design by doing design. So you all have some paper in front of you. So I want you all to take three sheets of paper. I'm going to start right out. Hey, I told you. This is interactive. I am going to put 3 minutes on my clock. You are going to take the sheets of paper. You are going to build the tallest tower you possibly can. Ready, go. Ten seconds left. Three, two, one, stop. Stop, 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 stop. Okay. Stop, stop, stop. All right. Okay. All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, who has the tallest tower? You have the tallest tower. Who has the tallest tower? These guys? They do. They do? But is that taller? That's there. That looks taller than that one. Oh, it fell over. That one seems to only have paper. Well, that one has more than paper. Yeah. It's only what? It's only three sheets of paper. Did I? Wait, what? Oh, so wait. You actually wrote the tallest tower on it. That's awesome. Okay, so why are we having this struggle to define what's the tallest tower and what isn't?
Because the specs are vague.
The specs are vague, right? What
all,
else?
We're
all competitive. We are at Harvard, right? Competitive institution, right? What else? What do you guys think when I told you this? People were like, wait, what?
Not that the specs are vague, the actual instructions are vague enough.
Yeah, so what's implied there? So yeah, the instructions are vague,
yeah.
Purposely, on my part.
We interpret it as, well, you don't necessarily have to use.
Aha, you interpret it. What does that mean by you interpreted it? What? Say that again? Success looks different. Why? Why does success look different?
Some people thought it was written, some people thought it was
folded. Right. Yeah. It's all based on what you assume. Right? So this is all based on assumptions. How come nobody tried to make a tower that wasn't out of paper? You guys made a tower that wasn't out of paper at all.
We used other things.
Aha. So you used other things, great. I didn't say you could or couldn't, right? I said take three sheets of paper. Build the tallest tower. I didn't say you had to use those three sheets, did I? Some of you were like, can we build together? Because that means we have more sheets. Okay, interesting. I've done this before where everybody in the workshop, and there's like 30 people in the room, not one person says, hey, let's work together. They just assume they have to do it by themselves. All right, so when you're designing stuff, what are you assuming? Big point number one, what are your assumptions, right? It's really important to think about what you're assuming when you're designing something. So, what do you guys think design is? So that was a fun little warm-up exercise, and we're going to be doing more of these type of things. So good job. On collectively, rather than clap, collectively on three, can we all just say nice really loudly? Can we do that? One, two, three.
Nice.
All right, we'll do that as a good job rather than clapping. So what do you guys, what's design to you guys? I want to hear what, you know, this is the fundamentals of design. What is your definition of design? Yes?
Problem solving.
Problem solving. Awesome. What else?
I mean, I'd add elegant.
Elegant. Elegant. Oh, so you'd add elegant problem solving. Yes. What else? Easy to understand, it's easy to access. Great, what else? A different way of thinking. Yeah, awesome.
Functional.
It's functional, right? And we can go to lots of things here, right? Just like, you know, build a tower with three pieces of paper, there's a lot of assumptions. Design's a very vague and slightly ambiguous word. It could mean a number of different things. I think the first answer was great. It's a way to solve problems. And if we can think about how to find something that's feasible, is it actually possible to do it? Is it desirable? Do people want it? You can design the coolest thing in the world, but if nobody wants it, well, it may not be so cool, and it may not make you a lot of money. How many have heard of plenty of startups that have spent tons and tons of money on something to design something that seems really cool, but nobody wants it? Yes, yes. What's what was Sean Parker's latest thing? Face something? No. Huh?
Okay, hello.
That one, but there was also one before. It was a video thing. I want to say FaceTime, but that's the wrong one. Airtime, that's what it was. Airtime. See, I can't even remember the name. Look, just Google Sean Parker Airtime. He spent tons of money. He did the talk show host's circuit for the launch. And in a few days, nobody really wanted it. So yeah, it's got to be, even though it was kind of cool and slick, nobody wanted it, so not a really good business. Might have been well designed, but was it designed that it solved any problem? Maybe not. And then is it viable? Are you going to make a business out of it? All right. So going to kick it off with this. Is a very short video by Hasselman, Hartman Esselman. He's the founder of Frog Design. It's kind of a cool little video, and I like the guy's attitude. And you'll see why in a minute.
'82, there was no design scene in America. Everybody was a corporate suck it up. And then I just felt the world is full of idiots when it comes to design. And decided to make my own company. People say, yeah, Frog is expensive. I said, I take that as a compliment. Frog is effing good. I mean, you can say that form for dysfunction has been abused as an excuse for shitty design. An absolutely boring, inhuman architecture. Products are not for themselves, products are for us. And that must be understood that it's not about aesthetics and being cool or whatever. It's about the real life, improving real life. People want to be convinced by emotion, not by rational. Rendering says nothing. I mean, it has no proportion, it has no feeling of touch, there's no feeling in space. When you prototype something and simulate, you get much better decisions for the next step. And if you don't have that, you go through with the end, you have just to wait what's coming out. I did models, I love to make models. And I think that's one of the methods people don't understand. Okay, it's naughty, it's you get dirty, but it's the best way to do it. I mean, there are many good ideas out there, but where's a radical idea, you know? Does it have to be rectangular because of a display? Today's designers always make those boring boxes that don't understand symbols anymore. If it's accepted quick, it's not good. Steve Jobs was scared like hell when he first saw this little product. So that's very small, but it's good. Are you sure? I said, yes, I am sure. I think you always should do more than people ask for. Or we shouldn't only look at what they ask for, but what they would like to do if they would have the courage to ask for. The question is, how can designers change the world? Design cannot. Designers can change the world.
So a little fun from Hartman. He's got a, I kind of dig his attitude. It's a little, sort of against the grain in some sense, but you know, he touched on a handful of things here that I hope we touched on today and hope you can walk out of here with. And you know, it's the first thing I had you guys do was building something. Like I said, you don't learn design by just sitting down. You learn by doing it. Design's pretty, this is sort of selling you on the why, right? I think you're all here because you feel like it's important. there's a couple anecdotes on how it's actually really helped a company. And a lot of people will look at Apple and say, yeah, they're great design. And they really, it shows when you look at, I think this is S&P over the last 10 years or so, 228% above with design-centric versus non-design-centric. So it clearly has a significant amount of value. And so to your comment earlier, yeah, it's a, how do you turn design, make it a problem-solving machine? It isn't just making things pretty. It's not decoration, right? So we're gonna roll the clock back. Remember these things? This is where I'm showing my age, right? And do you remember that they had this little sticker on it that said, be kind, rewind? So we're gonna go back and we're gonna be designers for a company called Star Video. And they came to us with a problem because we're problem solving designers. And they said, hey, okay, couple things. We gotta figure out how to solve this be kind, rewind thing, because it's the number one complaint on our postcards. Like they would, back then they didn't have Yelp or any other kind of like mobile phone, smartphone rating system, right? They would get postcards back from their customers saying, I hate that I have to rewind a video, like before I watch it. Like I'm tired of this, even though these little stickers didn't really do much. So they tried things like late fees, or fees for not rewinding. And that was kind of, well, little friction point, right? Because then it's like, oh, you didn't rewind it, so it cost you $5. Wow, that's not very fun now, is it? So you got three constraints. How do you do this to get 99 or more adoption? No additional burden on the customer or store employee. Low cost, easy implementation. Remember, this is like 1989, right? How do you solve this? So I'm gonna give you guys, I think I said 60, but I'm gonna give you guys actually 90 seconds, because you're in a little bit of a group, there'll be some time to discuss. How would you solve this problem? Right? Ready? Go. All right, time's up. Time's up. All right. Okay, designers, how did you solve this problem? What you got in the back? Rewind before you watch. What do you mean?
So instead of having customers rewind at the end,
aha.
Before they watch.
Cool. Awesome. What else? What other solutions we got? A case that automatically rewinds it. Let's go back to number two. No burden or low cost. Number three, is that going to be expensive? It's 1989. What else we got?
An incentive that your next rental is free if you rewind it.
Okay, great.
We had a couple. One was designed like a cassette tape where you have to flip it over in the middle so that the
So it's like an old 80s cassette audio tape, right? Like get to the end, up, stop, turn it around, and make it slice like the most important scene. Up, sorry, that's gonna go really well with the customer experience, won't it? Were you here last week for Richard's experience mapping at all? Okay. What else? Yes.
You have the last 30 seconds of the tape make sort of an obnoxious noise.
The last 30 seconds. Do you ever watch the last 30 seconds?
Well,
what happens when the credits start rolling? Yeah, okay. What else?
Behind you.
Yes.
You could start like a propaganda campaign and have a poster of the sad faces and of like vignettes about how people have missed important.
Okay. Wouldn't it be kind of costly though?
What if you just had like a VCR or a cassette machine in the store and just asked to rewind before you return?
Okay. Additional burden, right? Think about that.
Lobby the VCR makers to have it automatically.
Ah, auto rewind, that's cool, right? But not everyone has an auto rewinding VCR. So still, your adoption rate might be a lot less. Yes?
So if the customer brings back a tape that's not rewinded, shame them by releasing a photo or name.
Shame them, public shame, shaming. Remember, there's no Facebook in 89. It's a little hard to do that. Yes?
So this might be a little bit in violation of requirement solid. You
correct.
You can stamp a frown face on top of that. So as soon as the person takes the VHS tape out of their
they see a
player, they see the frown.
Ah. Getting a little probably low cost, but so actually the first suggestion was actually one of the suggestion that they implemented. They actually flipped, they just said instead of be kind, rewind, they said this tape might need to be rewound. It costs pennies per tape, right? And your insight to say, well, you gotta rewind it once anyways. If you're gonna rewind it at the end, why don't you just force them to rewind it at the beginning? So so it would be get the video, bring it home, watch it, and then rewind it. That's what the current state was. And then they're saying, well, get it, bring it home, rewind it, and then watch it. And all this did was just take that expectation, right? So a tiny little sticker. So great, awesome. Psychological value, very, very important, right? Very low cost. I also teach at a business school in Madrid, and some of the MBA students are talking about all sorts of whiz-bang tech stuff. And I'm like, didn't you guys like read the constraints? It's doesn't kind of expensive what you're talking about. So that psychological value is really, really important. And that's big about in design. One of the things about being a designer is you actually have to be a little bit of a psychologist. You have to understand people, right? Remember what Hartman was saying. People, the products are for people. So let's make sure we think about that. These are quotes from Dieter Rams when he decided, you guys know who Dieter Rams is? Some of you might, some of you might not. When he wrote, "What is design?" Last one is, I think, the most striking. It's as little design as possible. Right? It's the design that actually solves the problem and no more. Don't over-design something, because there's definitely plenty of things that have been over-designed for sure. Have you ever seen your television remote control? There's probably 1,000 buttons on it. You might use maybe 8 to 10 of them, probably 2 or 3. So. This is Dieter Rams. I want you to take a close look at some of those products. Do they look familiar? This is Ivy from Apple, right? Designers do borrow, right? Don't ever try to design something from scratch. You gotta be inspired by other design. So always think about that. Anybody here a designer? One, how do you design something?
I use software platforms like Rhino or SolidWorks.
So you use a particular tool,
yeah.
And you jump straight into designing something.
Well, I would probably start out with designing it in my head, and then move to a paper if necessary, and pencil, and then commit to the CAD.
So you have little stages of things you do before you actually start designing something. And you said CAD, so you're designing 3D models? Great. Cool. So we're going to talk about a handful of principles of design. These are going to be initially applied to visual design, but we'll actually talk about how to apply them to a larger context. First thing is proximity. Things that are near each other should go together, right? Second one, alignment. Things are aligned, right? Repetition. Do things repeat, not just in number, but in style, in font, in concept. Contrast, and isn't just color. It could be contrasting topics, contrasting items, contrasting ideas, tension, because contrast creates tension. And the last one is color. So just think park. Okay? Let's think about this. Does these numbers mean anything to you right now? Probably not. But do they mean anything to you now? Aha. Why? Because it changed the proximity. Right? And a little bit of alignment. Right? That is not a real number, by the way, even though it's 617 area code, as you can tell. So if you dial it, I don't know who might answer. Let's take another example of a business card. Let's design a business card. Right? Let's align it. Put things together that go together. Maybe add a little bit of color and contrast. But if I start changing things around, do things look a little strange? Right? Does that look a little strange? Does that sit well with you? No, it's not quite aligned right, right? So there's probably different things you could do. Same thing here. There's a lot of different things you can play with. Always just playing visually with those little things. Okay? So let's design something. But before we jump into it, I'm going to ask you all, who can draw? Who can draw? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. About 10 to 15% of you, and what, maybe 80 or so? Okay. If I asked a room full of 9-year-olds, I would, everybody's hand would be like this. What happened? What happened between 9 and now, however old you are now? What happened? Somebody tell me, what happened between 9 and now? Why suddenly you could draw then and you can't draw now? Oh, your expectation changed. You didn't say anything about your drawing ability. I want to know why your drawing ability changed between 9 and now.
Like, mine actually did not change.
Yeah, that's Oh. Right, let's go back to the first thing. What were our assumptions? Right? I didn't ask you if you could draw well. I asked you if you could draw. Of course you all can draw. And you're going to prove it to me right now. I'm going to give you 30 seconds, and you're going to draw the person sitting next to you. Oh, God. Ready? Go. All right, time's up. I said 30 seconds. How'd that go? Some of you are still drawing. Stop drawing. Stop. What do we got? Who wants to share theirs? Who wants to be brave and share theirs? This person wants to share his. You're being volunteered. You can share it for him. All right. He's like, yeah, okay, that's it. Who else? Yes. Cool. Who is that? Is that him? Very nice. Nice. Very cool. Very cool. I heard a couple sorries. Why? I heard a couple, I apologize. Why? Who did apologize? I know I heard a couple of you say that. Why did you apologize?
Because I felt I really wouldn't be able to capture
him. You felt you wouldn't be able to capture him. Right. Who else apologized? Yes, why did you apologize? Your unfavored hand.
Yeah, like I'm not left-handed, so.
She's like, oh, so you decided I'm going to purposely draw with my wrong hand.
You're kind of supposed to, but, you know,
so cool.
I drew the top half of this guy's head, and that's it.
Right, and you just ran out of time.
I got sunglasses, like a
nice. So I'm curious, why? So, but you apologized.
Yeah.
Why?
Because you know, he finished.
You apologized for not finishing then.
Yeah, I mean
he's only got half a head.
Yeah.
Okay, who else apologized? Yes?
I apologize because I don't want to offend her.
Oh, you don't want to offend them. Interesting. Why?
She had really nice teeth and I was trying to show that.
Okay. So you were trying to go straight to the detail. You were like, I want to show the teeth.
Yes.
Like you went straight to a detail. Okay. Interesting. Who else has another, who else apologized who wants to, So you made them into something that they're not.
Yeah.
Okay. But it's just a drawing. It's just a 30-second drawing, right? Why you don't need to apologize for that. Yes?
I apologize because it ended up looking like an FBI Most Wanted.
FBI Most Wanted. This reminds me actually of Dia de los Muertos in Mexico a little bit. Very cool. But part of it is, as designers, you gotta get over that. You gotta get over that fear of this embarrassment, I can't create something, I can't. You gotta put that aside. You gotta have that 9-year-old mind for something. You have that sort of fearless, like, I'm gonna do this, like, I got this, okay? So you gotta get over that, really important, okay? It's not easy, especially because you're like, oh, I don't wanna offend them. But just the more you do it, it's like a muscle, right? And there's a reason why I'm doing these little bite-sized exercises on the way. I'm kind of building your brains up. Like muscles, right? You don't just go out and ride the Tour de France tomorrow. You train for it slowly over time. Same thing here. Okay? All right. So let's just think for sketch for a second. Who's near and far? A or B? Right. Assuming that the line is a horizontal, right? Probably think A is bigger, right? Or A is nearer, sorry. Right? Because it doesn't have to be a perfect representation of something. All you're trying to do is conceptually flesh something out. And this is where some of you, like, she went back to specifically, you know, try to draw the teeth. Now, have you studied art and drawing before?
No.
Okay. But she's trying to go straight to a tiny detail. Think about that for a second. As a designer, you don't go straight to the detail, right? When designing your, let's say you're designing a web app, do you design the login button immediately? Is it the first thing you do? No, right? So be careful about jumping straight into a detail. We all have this propensity to just want to dive right in and go straight to a detail or two. Be careful of that. As a designer, pull yourself back, okay? Again, these are just a couple examples on ways that you can conceptually show something visually. First, if you're designing something, it doesn't have to look perfect or finished or polished, okay? So we're going to spend the rest of this redesigning. I will read this out loud to you. For those of you who can't quite see it, it says, "Hello there, thank you for flying Delta. I am sure you are no doubt trying to figure out what the F to do with the piece of paper you have in your hand right now. You are confused, lost, and just want to get on your flight. It's cool. We don't really care, and we sure as hell don't want to make this process easy and enjoyable for you. Instead, we hired a small blind parakeet to lay out your boarding pass, you know, just to keep you guessing. Have fun." So this is this is Tyler Thompson. He got really pissed off because he missed his flight out of JFK a few years ago, and he decided he's going to redesign the boarding pass, and he posted this up to his blog. So we're going to start doing this, all right? This is going to be our task for the next, but, right? So we have our principles of design. We have proximity and contrast and repetition and alignment, right? Park. Color's not on this particular one, but color's kind of like icing on the cake. Like, you got to get the cake right first and then ice it. But if you don't get the cake right, doesn't matter how much icing you have, you only have icing. So we have these. We also, I didn't get into this, but in terms of visual design, we have these elements, right? Lines, colors, textures, sizes, spaces. And you can think about, depending on what you're designing, these may change. Your elements may change, right? He talked about tools of CAD, but he did start out with drawing something, perhaps, in his head, but also probably thinking about lines and shapes and spaces and colors, and how do you put them all together. What's missing? Materials. What's missing?
Requirements.
What's missing?
What are we going to design?
What are you going to design? We're going to redesign the boarding pass, the airline, the flight ticket. So that's what we're going to design. What else is missing? People. Thank you. People are missing, right? Who are we designing for? People, right? Remember what Hartmut said. People, the products are for people. So who are you designing for? Who needs to use an airline ticket? Which people? People who like to fly. What would you call them? Frequent flyers. Passengers. Who else? People don't like to fly?
That lady at the gate.
The lady at the gate. Oh, yes. What are they called?
I don't know.
Right? So here's what I want you to do. I'm going to give you guys a few minutes. I want you to just list out all the people who would touch an airline ticket. Who are they? Who are you designing this airline pass for? ¿Qué más? All right. Okay. Who did you guys, how many, let's firstly just do a count. How many had more than 3? How many more than 5? How many more than 10? How many more than 15? Wow. Who are some of the ones you guys had? You don't have to list them all, but just give me a few. Give me a few of the rare ones. The what?
The fingerless.
The fingerless.
Blind people.
Interesting. Who else?
Pets.
Because they do have airline tickets. I've traveled with my dog before. Yeah. What else?
Business people.
Okay.
Unaccompanied minors.
How many had unaccompanied minors? All right. Nice. I love it. Cool. What is this doing? What is this doing? Why am I having you do this? I'm not having you draw stuff yet, right? Why am I having you do this first?
Segmenting,
right? What did you guys learn from Richard last week? No. Or for those who were here.
Know your customers.
Who are your customers, right? Who are the people on this list that you need to please, that you need to really design for? Now, in theory, you've got to design for all of them, but some of the people you can have more friction than others, right? Some of these people are more important. They're not all equally important. Somebody who never shops duty-free doesn't need to show their airline ticket to that particular person. But understanding who they all are, really important. So you want to diverge, do the exhaustive list, right? This is a lot of what design is, like diverge, come up with lots of different things, figure out, okay, stop, analyze, then converge back down. Happens a lot, okay? So, now, take a few minutes to think about what are they gonna do? What should they do? What do they do? And write that down. Like, so you have who, and then do, right? And somewhere there's you think and you are, but that's a whole other thing. So who do? Like, so what do these people need to do? What do they need to do with an airline ticket? What information do they need, right? So spend a few minutes thinking about that and for each of the different folks that you've outlined. Cool? Give you guys a few minutes to do that. Go. Yes. All right, 30 more seconds. All right, let's bring it back in. Okay. 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 So, there was a question over here. What did you ask me? Right, so her question was, is it a paper ticket or is something else? And so it's kind of jumping ahead a little bit, but what is that alluding to, that kind of question? Constraints and even potential what the solution might be. And constraints are good, and we'll get to that in a little bit. But that was awesome. And you guys back there were talking about barcodes.
Yeah.
Right, and why? So that everybody scanning the barcode would be able to see your face. So the identification, so you're sort of looking at a functional thing of, hey, we need to identify people, and that's why they have your name. It's an identification mechanism. But name is only one way of many to identify people. You can actually identify people by face, right? Okay, cool. Great, so now you've got who you're designing for, you've got what they need to do, what information they need, what do they need to do with that information, so thinking about that, right? Now I want you to, and maybe you guys talked a little bit about this, but I want you to interview somebody at your table about how their last flight was. So just ask them to tell the story of their last flight. Okay? And I'll give you guys about 5 minutes to tell that story. All right? You really want to get the details. Where did they go? What happened? All right? Have somebody scribing. Okay? 5 minutes to figure that out, to do that. All right, wrap up those interviews. Which team would like to share their interview? Which team would like to share? Who wants to? You guys back there? All right. Your first hand I saw. Okay. So who was the interviewee? Who was the person interviewed? You were the person interviewed? Great. All right, so I'm gonna leave
this to
you guys.
I thought I wouldn't talk, but.
No, you're gonna talk a little bit. So what were you guys, firstly from you guys, what did you guys ask? Tell me a little bit about your interview strategy. What did you ask her about?
So originally we started just as like a group. We decided to have like a group discussion about our flights. So we started with I'm sorry, how do you pronounce your name?
Constantina.
Constantina. And we just started going around in the circle. And so Constantina just started explaining her story. And then after a while, we just prompted her with a few more questions, right?
Mm-hmm.
So she started off with her story, and she was flying from Greece to the United States, right? And the first thing that she tells us is that she was
Can you hold the microphone?
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
And then the first thing that she tells us was that she was very hungry, right? So she describes that although the food was all right, it wasn't like your standard, like disgusting airplane food. There wasn't enough of it, and she felt hungry throughout the trip.
Okay. Good. Yes. Comment.
I just wanted to say that I wanted to emphasize on the fact that I felt that the quantity was not enough. Because
okay.
Usually people
you
say
are
that.
Hungry.
No, it's like the food usually is not good. That's why people end up not eating. But I thought that even if I took maximum advantage of it, maybe still I would have been hungry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. So something came out of this interview that wasn't necessarily intended, right?
Mm-hmm.
You were initially interviewing her about her flight and to a little bit understanding how she used a ticket, right? But something else came out about hunger and food along the way. This happens, right? This part of design is called design research, right? This is going understanding your users. Did Richard, I think the people who were here last week probably learned a little bit about empathy. You've got to understand your users, especially the people who aren't you, because they're going to give you a perspective on something you may not have seen. For example, I love these guys who are like, yeah, the fingerless. Wow. Because that's obviously to think about when you think about who uses an airline ticket is somebody who doesn't have fingers. Right? But there's some perspective that they had that they brought to that. Really interesting. That may not have come out otherwise. There's a great video somewhere on YouTube. There's a lot of great videos on YouTube, I should say. But there's one about, it shows a gentleman from the shoulders up going down the gangway onto an airplane and getting to his seat. And then when he gets to his seat, he realizes he can't turn the lights on or anything like that because he has no arms. So he has to actually figure out how to use his feet to do that. Think about from a design perspective, that's an interesting constraint to think about. And the people who designed the aircraft probably weren't thinking about somebody who doesn't have arms who might actually use the airline. So anything else come out of your interviews?
She spoke that she had a connection, so she actually needed two boarding passes, and also one of the flights she was seated next to this baby that would not stop crying.
Okay.
It was like crying continuously.
Can I interfere here? Because this this sounded terrible, and I love babies, and I didn't say, no.
It's okay. You're not under attack here at all. We're not judging you.
I'm just saying that I mentioned it as a possible thing to be improved.
Yes. Interesting, right? And so now when you do design research like this, you're going to hear about a whole bunch of things that may be tangential, but somewhat related to what you're initially designing about. You need to listen for those, because sometimes they'll give you some really big ahas. And your initial design problem of, hey, redesign the ticket, may turn into something completely different, because you may have stumbled on a much bigger problem. And that's where you need to focus your design energy. Cool. Anything else from you guys? Okay. How about one more? One more team want to share their interview? Come on, be brave. All right. Which one was interviewed?
I was interviewed.
You were interviewed? Okay. Who did anyone do
group
most?
Thing.
Group thing? Somebody want to be a spokesperson for the group? You guys are like, no, not me.
All right.
Okay. Tell us a little bit about what you did for interviewing and what did you learn?
So I interviewed Lane, is that correct? Lane. Actually, we all contributed. And he was telling us about a really bad experience he had traveling to Ohio.
I love Ohio, though.
It took him a lot longer to get there. First of all, it was too expensive to book a direct flight. So instead, he was getting a connection from New York to Ohio, and that was delayed, and then he ended up waiting a long time he was waiting around for that flight, and then he ended up getting there 2 hours after he was originally supposed to be there. Is that correct?
And one of the flights was
one
canceled.
One of the flight was canceled.
Mm-hmm.
It was just overall a bad experience.
Interesting. So this team focused on a negative experience. Did anyone have a positive experience that they were talking about? Or was it all negative? You all had good. You guys had good ones. All right, let's tell us a little bit about the positive experience here.
So Will and I actually flew together.
I'm Will.
From San Francisco to Boston, and I thought it was great. You could order with Virgin America. You could order drinks from your seat, and they had plugs and like adapters, and so it was. I thought it was great. They took off on time. They landed early.
Okay. Did anybody ask about what happened before the airline or even afterwards
TSA
at all?
TSA pre-check. Yeah. Huh? TSA pre-check.
TSA pre-check.
It's,
anyone
it's
else
all
before
good.
That and before that and before that and afterwards? She wants to know if you're old enough to drink.
Depends who you're traveling with.
Thank you. All right. So 1, 2, 3. Oh. Once again, 1, 2, 3.
Nice.
All right, good job. Thank you guys for sharing your interviews. So there's plenty of fields of research, depth of research on design or of articles on design research. And this is a tiny little snapshot. But going out and talking to your users, really, really important. And listening for things that you may have walked in with a particular mindset about. In this case, fixing a ticket or understanding how to improve a ticket, but coming out with many other things. So this is going to change that do a little bit, perhaps, right? You look back at what you wrote down for the do part of the who do, some of that might change based on those interviews. Why? Probably because some of your assumptions may have changed as you talk to these people. Like, oh yeah, we thought they were going to do this, but they actually did that instead, right? Yeah, you're not, you're like, yes, okay, totally. So one of the things we can do a little bit that I know Richard touched on was the experience map. This right here is from Adaptive Path, and this is about buying and traveling on the train in Europe. And so when you think about this, this is what is your whole context? What is the whole context of before they even start the service, during and after? And this is just a zoom in of one particular element, particularly as it relates to getting the itinerary and waiting for your tickets, et cetera. This is what we use at Constant Contact a lot. I've only been there about a year and a half, and this is something that's been really helpful to help the product teams understand how to design stuff, because you're thinking about the user in really a sense of before they use your product, what's going on? What are they doing, right? Before you even get to the airport, before you even have to pull out that or even get that ticket from the counter, what's going on? What happens during? What happens during your flight? Or during the process of being in the airport and on the plane and then after the airport? Right? And then what happens even after? So thinking about before, during, and after is really, really important. I know Richard touched on this a little bit with experience maps. And I want you guys to take some of the information you have with, like, pick one of your who, like, you pick the passenger, right? Think about how to draw out that journey. Think about just sketching that out a little bit. What are the different goals at each? What are the different stages, right? Here's a couple examples. And notice that one side of this map has a little empathy map of, hey, who is this person? What are they feeling? What are they thinking? What are they seeing? What are they saying? Right? Really important to understand that. Again, you got to understand people, right? You think about it. What are the five senses? So there's a guy named Jinsup Lee. He looked at, he was a teacher, and he asked his students to rate their sensory experience with different things. This is a sensory experience of instant noodles. This was when they go clubbing. Now you see, obviously, sound gets a lot higher. Why is taste a 4? Apparently, okay, drinking, but apparently also kissing was part of the student's reaction. Was that okay? So that's why they rated taste a 4, right? And then, of course, you look at something like great sex, which has really high on the different sensory inputs, right? So let's take this same type of thing and think about, well, what is your experience through an airport with a plane with a ticket? What are your sensory, what does that look like? Right? So I want you guys to spend a few minutes thinking about that, right? What does this look like for air travel? What is the sight? What is the smell? What is the taste? So spend a few minutes thinking about that. All right, and think about it. And initially, the initial problem was about tickets, right? And getting lost and having a ticket that didn't help them out. So think about it in that regard too. Keep that in mind. Don't lose sight of your initial problem. Even though you may have discovered others, let's not lose sight of our initial problem. Cool? All right, I'll give you guys a few minutes for that. All right, go. Okay. Let me just get a little bit of clarification from a couple questions here that are coming up similarly. So the y-axis, think about it in best in terms described as like level of engagement. How engaged is your sight? How engaged is your touch when you're flying, right? So just think about that from the clubbing example. Obviously, your hearing is engaged a lot more because there's loud music. Great sex, obviously, lots of things are engaged, okay? Just to give you put that into context, all right? So just wanted to clarify that, give you guys a couple more minutes, keep going. No, it doesn't. It has an on-off switch. That's it. After, when you guys finish this, it's okay. The idea is, it's a little ambiguous purposely. So, because your taste is engaged, obviously, smell, it's exact, number, right? You can easily find them. Yeah.
So would you call?
I mean, this is just a
sensory matrix or something.
Okay. All right, guys, let's bring it back in. How did that go? Anyone have any comments about their experience from that one? Yes.
We did the whole 5-cent canvas of the experience.
Yep.
And then we started talking about that whole sort of Louis C.K. view of the world.
Which I'm going to actually put this on you just to...
Start again?
Yeah, please.
Okay, so we did the 5... That's not working. We need a better design.
Does that work?
I like it. You guys are thinking. One of designers spotting problems is a very key skill for a designer. So good.
We did the whole sense canvas thing and the experience, and then we remembered the whole Louis C.K. thing, which says everything's amazing, no one's happy. And so we talked about, flying is amazing. Generally, when everything's working well, like that whole fact is a 10. But then when we dive into the components of the experience, then we remember the upholstery smells awful. And there's not much to look at, really. And we talked about Japan Airlines has this camera that can point down. And so you can sort of see the earth below you as you fly. So there are these little cues. But
we
catch the whole thing and, flying is amazing.
Cool. Thank you. 1, 2, 3. Oh, come on. Support your classmate. 1, 2, 3.
Nice.
There we go. All right. Now, you guys over here had a really interesting thing. Can one of you guys show the class and tell a little bit about where your strategy was with this? I saw this was great.
Okay, so we did a diagram of before, during, and after. And under that did sight, touch, smell, sound, and taste. And then ranked each of those for each of those three different experiences.
Right, so they sort of took that journey of, hey, the experience before you fly is gonna be gonna engage certain senses in this way. The engage when you're actually in the airline is gonna be something else. And so the key out of here is that it's not a static thing, right? These are just snapshots of states in time. Hence why when you think about journey maps like this, you're just getting little slices in time of them, okay? And the reason why I had you do the little sensory matrix was to get you to think about how does somebody feel when they're going through this, right? Remember what Hartman said, like people's emotions are what buy most products. Like most of the product decisions you make are typically from an emotional perspective. Most of them, not all of them. We often emotionally buy them and then rationalize why we bought them later. Okay, that often happens. So if you can tap into that as a designer, you can design a better product. And so you understand them. You ever had a conversation with somebody and like, oh my God, they get me? Right? Does that ever happen to you? Like, nobody ever gets me. But when that happens, you're like, oh, that's great. They understand me, right? Same thing when you have a delightful product, right? Like, oh, wow, that was really cool that they did that. Right? There's a great case study of somebody coming, a family coming back into their hotel room there at Walt Disney World. They came back in, and I think they had left the kids' toys and some sneakers in a corner, not packed in a bag or anything. And what the hotel cleaning ladies did was took the towels and actually made them into little creatures that were interacting with their sneakers and toys on the floor, right? Subtle little thing, but it was a total delightful experience, right? Thinking about how do you raise that from... I mean, all they could have functionally, they could have just cleaned the room, but they actually made it a much better experience because they understood that the parents probably, they've got a couple kids, bring them to Disney World. Okay, it's a handful to bring kids traveling anyway, so let's make it a delightful experience when they come back and not have to worry about, oh, the kids left their sneakers on the floor, right? Thinking about that, right? That's going to make that family far more likely to probably go back to Disney World again sometime in the future, right? Think about that. So that's sort of the design mentality that we got to try to adopt. And by these tools can help us get there. Okay? So when we think about this, let's go back to our original problem. It was, hey, dude's lost, can't read the ticket, still trying to make his flight. Okay? How do you design this? Right? What, how, given what you've done, you've had it, you've actually interviewed a passenger. We've thought about the different people that need to, we've thought about what they need to do along with it. We've thought about some of the sensory input or sensory engagement that you have along the way, right? Now, how would we go about redesigning this? And so this is where the question of constraints comes in. Are we doing it digital only? Or are we doing it paper only? Does it have to be both? And can you pull up your example you showed me? So these guys pulled up an example and said, hey, here's an example of a flight today. Was it today? You flew today? All right. Here's this. Okay. And can you read this? It's hard to read a barcode with your own naked eye, is it? But then you look at this. This is actually pretty damn hard to read, too. So it's not necessarily, even the electronic ones could be a little bit different, right? So let's bring back our friends, proximity, alignment, repetition, contrast. That, and think about how we would design that, whether it be digitally or electronically. But think about the whole experience. So now we've got a much more context around what we need. This is the key to being a designer, understanding that context before you actually try to go make a solution. Okay? So what would you guys go do? So I'll give you guys some time to actually think about how would you design this stuff. What would you design? And then I'm going to have you show your designs to the table next to you. Because designers need to get feedback and prototype. So I'm going to give you guys about, let's see, we end at 6, right? Yeah. So I'll give you guys about 6 minutes to design something, and then we'll do a share with the table next to you.
I would only print them in one page, and then you can follow it.
It says what time it departs, but it doesn't tell you like what time it departs.
Do you really care about the flight number or the where you're going?
And the airline maybe sometime?
And then the flight number.
We're missing the flight number.
No, destination. The destination. Yeah. Usually,
it's like a scene how your eye travels. It's going to be tilted. We know it's leaving.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
A little funnel good. Like Catrista. Where are you? This is not right. Maybe just like that.
We're there.
No. We don't care. Yeah.
Okay. All right, everybody. Here we go. So what you're going to do now you've got your design, or as finished as you're going to for this exercise. What I want you to do is turn around to the table next to you, and whoever goes first or second, it doesn't matter. I want you guys to just show them the ticket. Here's the thing. Hang on. Wait, guys. The team showing the ticket can't explain it. You cannot explain your ticket. You just have to give it to them and sit and listen to what they say. How do they interpret it? All right? All right? So ready? So go, so like swap tables or whatever. Just turn around, go to the table next to you, and give them your ticket. And stand, ask them. The only thing you do is ask one question of like, how useful is it? And then STFU, shut up and listen. Okay? I'm going to time you. You're going to get about 4 minutes per ticket, right? So time box it, right? 4 minutes each. You want to listen, just like you did with the interview before.
Real estate and you're like losing it.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. 1, 2, 3. All right. Let's try that one more time. 1, 2, 3. All right. Good. What did you guys learn when you presented your product to somebody else? It was more confusing than they thought, than you thought.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. Why was it more confusing than you thought?
Well, because you thought it was organized in a logical way, but it wasn't clear to them what the organization was.
Yeah, so it was completely organized in your head, but in their head they were like, what? Okay, what else? What do you guys have?
We are going in the right path and we can build on it.
Okay, so you got feedback that you're on the right path, but you need some tweaks. Yes.
Each other. They use icons, which we did not use. And okay. Their icons supplemented like the semantics of what they were trying to work with. We went with prominence and no icons.
So icons versus prominence?
Yeah, you learn, obviously learn from each other, but we also were able to kind of critique what little aspect is missing between the idea of something like prominence or highlight.
Sorry.
We were able to.
Oh, little tiny thing on the bottom.
So we were able to judge each other's work based on the difference between, like, the nuance between what an icon does for people that are trying to use a ticket. Customer service obviously doesn't need stuff like that so much, but, you know, just kind of, like, parse that out versus what we did, which was more about prominence, like, gate numbers, enormous compared to whatever those little letter
yeah.
and number
combinations
mean.
And that's why he couldn't
mean,
find
you know?
The gate number. He, yeah. The seat number was perfectly legible for him, but the gate number was, like, really tight. He's like, where the hell am I going to go, blah, 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 blah. Cool. Any other things that you've learned doing it? How many of you actually tried to explain your ticket? How many of you felt the urge like, oh my God, well, no, you're not reading it right. You're not looking at it right. How many of you felt that? Yeah? Yeah, that happens. You got to pull that back. You got to rein that in. Just like the whole, you know, 9-year-old draw, like as a designer, you got to resist that urge, right? You got to resist the urge to try to tell people how to use the product that you designed. Right, and hopefully you experience that a little bit, right? Because you just got to put it in their hands and let them use it and see. It's not. And did anyone apologize for not understanding it right? Anyone like looking at a ticket? Anyone sort of apologize? Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't quite understand that. That happen at all? Yes? No? Oftentimes it happens when we design products and it's people. Oh, I'm sorry, I don't understand that. I must be doing it wrong. No, you're not using it wrong. We designed it wrong, right? It's not broken user, it's broken product. Okay, so as a designer, you have to be very mindful of that. So the listening is really, really important. Just like listening when we're doing design research, when we're interviewing the traveler, listening to what they were saying and how, like, not just what they were saying, but how they were saying it. Were they really, she was really hungry, right? So thinking about that and then getting that feedback, really, really, really important. This is how you become a designer. And you do this a lot. You build something, you put it in front of somebody, you STFU, pardon my acronyms, and you listen to what they say. You watch how they use it. All right? That feedback is really, really important because then it can take you to say, oh yeah, we're on the right track. Or no, actually icons, terrible idea. We need to do something else, right? So that is really important when you get your product in the hands of users, as you've probably learned from Abby in the whole lean startup mentality of getting your product out there as quickly as possible. So as little design as possible, similar things here. There's some definitely the similarities between design thinking and lean startup for sure. So let's see what Tyler came up with. So this was what he drew in his notebook. I think he drew this on the plane while he was waiting in the lounge while waiting for his next flight. So we started putting some things really large, like the size. So prominence, right? You talked about prominence. Big, really big, what time you're leaving, what gate you're leaving from, right? Then he actually made a digital mock-up of it. And he made a couple of them. Okay, this was Delta. Maybe add a little branding to it, make it look a little nicer. Maybe same layout, but different brand, okay, to show that the brand could be different. Notice that they still had the rip-off part of it, where you could, notice that some tickets actually rip that off and some don't. Why, right? You ever think about that? Well, why does some do that and some don't? That's kind of strange. Maybe some tickets do that and some don't, right? Then he posted this on his blog, and a couple of other people jumped in and decided that they would throw in their own hat and try a few different things. Again, think about proximity, alignment, repetition, contrast, color, right? Think about those uses here, but then think about those same concepts, proximity, alignment, contrast, color. Now think about that as a whole experience. What things are near each other, right? The gates are near each other. The baggage claims are near each other, right? Where's the alignment? Where's the repetition in that experience of going through becoming a traveler? This is interesting. Whoa, what happens when you see this? You're like, no, no, no. Why did the designer choose this? Why do you think the designer chose this? Yes? Forces you to actually slow down and read it. Exactly right.
But you know, so many people misread stuff all the time.
Yes, exactly. That could totally mess you up. Totally. And here's where the prototyping and getting it in the hands of the user would be really, really helpful. You'd realize that, hey, great, maybe only 1% of the people actually get lost, but maybe 99%, it works great for them, right? This is where the prototyping is really important. Yes? It actually talks to you?
Yeah, in English.
In English. What if you're not English? What if you don't speak English? Yes. But something to think about, like, that becomes an interesting design constraint is that, wow, what if you have somebody flying from like, say, Saudi Arabia, where there's not even using the Roman alphabet, right? Or Russia. Very different alphabets. China, very, very different alphabets. How does that work? Something to think about. Somebody changed the size. Did anybody change the size? Yeah. Does anyone know why the airline tickets are the size they are?
Yes.
Yes, why? Close, but it's actually before that. Yes.
I thought it was a scanner.
Not the scanner. Not quite punch cards, but why punch cards are those size? Huh? Yep, but why were they made that size? They could fit in an envelope. Boom. Yep, that's exactly right, because they could fit in the standard envelope. That's exactly, so they could mail them. Yeah, and everyone's like, what, really? Yeah, that's actually why airline tickets are still that size. somebody vertically made was vertically. It's the same form factor, but moved it vertically. How many of you thought about putting something on the back? Yeah, good. Starting to think about, like, there's more than just the front of the ticket. Sometimes there could be advertisements, the branding, or maybe you could use some other useful information to go back there, right? This was a digital one that somebody did. Again, this is all posted from Tyler's blog, or comments from and other people, right? So let's just think about, and we got a few minutes left, what just happened tonight, right? What did we go through? We went through essentially a meaning design cycle to try to get you guys to be designers, okay? So this is Stanford D School's, or maybe this, yeah. Design thinking process, like, what's the problem? What do you need to discover, right? Do some interviewing, do some interpretation of that research, like, what did you learn from that interview? Do some ideation, what does that look like? Who are the people you're designing for, right? What do they need to do? Ideate on that, try to create some concepts. Do some experimentation. Hey, let's try something and then let's give it to somebody who had actually use it and see what they think. Really important to do that. And then evolution, iterate, evolve, right? That's essentially a design cycle. These are the fundamentals of design. It seems like it's a linear process. You start at A, you go to B. It's not. It really looks like this. This is actually a thing called the design squiggle. It was designed by somebody from Central Design Agency in California. You can actually get it on a t-shirt because it really talks about what it looks like. Like the design, you sometimes feel like you're going, you know, three steps forward and then five steps back. It is that fuzzy front end when you're trying to figure the problem out. Before you really get to the ideation and evolution parts, you're really trying to go through cycles. And that's what it feels like. It should feel sticky. It should feel uncomfortable. Okay? And that's that getting comfortable with ambiguity is really important as a designer. So that's why some of these things, like, you know, as the exercises I've given you, like, okay, yeah, go build a tower that's with three sheets of paper. They're ambiguous for a reason, because you've got to learn to work in that and play in that. The more you can do that, the better the product you'll be able to make. Okay? So five things to walk away with today. Firstly, write your assumptions and challenge them, right? Write down your assumptions. What are they? And it's really important to actually write them down, because it's amazing how sometimes you might state one but then forget it. And challenge them. Like, do we have to work alone to create the tower? Do we have to only use paper? Okay, ask a lot of questions. Some of you did, like, hey, can we work alone? We have, what? So why? Why not? Why not open the back? Why not make it digital? Why not do this? Right? Really important to not just ask why, but also why not? Why was she hungry? Think of the who's, right? Who's using the product? And think of their senses. What are they feeling, seeing, hearing, touching? Okay? Map the whole process from pre-start to post-finish. Right? So think about before it even starts, what's going on? Understand that context. You'll be able to design something that may seamlessly flow into what they need to do. And then what happens after they engage with the product or service? What happens after you're done with the flight? Your ticket's still in your bag, you pull it out a week later, and oh, yeah, I remember this trip. It was late, I was hungry. Right? Or maybe, oh, it was an awesome trip. I got to order drinks next to my friend. And then remember park. Proximity, alignment, repetition, contrast, color. Those are things that can be really quickly, from a learning point of view, you can really apply that visually quickly and easily. And we did that today with our ticket. But you can also think about that more conceptually from any kind of product or service you design and how you interact with it. So those are the five things I hope you walk away with today. I think these slides will be available. Yeah?
So we'll be videoing it, and the video will be available in a couple of weeks on our learning library, and that'll include the slides in it.
Cool. So I'm curious to hear from you. So feedback's important, right? This is a prototype. All my classes are prototypes. Every single one of them is. What did you guys learn today? I'm really curious as to what stuck and what didn't stick. So I'd love to hear from you. What you learned the 1, 2, 3, nice. Okay, awesome. What else? What stuck today? Go ahead, just yell it out. Or you learned nothing? I'm in big trouble.
Give it to the user to figure out if the design works or not.
Give it to the user, great. What else? Yes, back there.
I really like the sensory.
Map out the senses, great, thank you.
People.
Huh?
Think of people first.
Think of people, yep. Awesome, yes. Think of before, during, after. Great.
Identify actions and steps, and then make them abstract.
So after identify things, abstract them a bit. Great. Yes. You had your hand up. Say that one more time.
Get feedback.
Get feedback. Awesome. Yes. And I'm looking for what you learned. I'm not asking you to repeat what we talked about. I'm asking you things that you're going to walk away with. Yes.
I feel like to slow down at the beginning. Do you know what I mean? Like you said, my instinct is to jump into details and
yeah.
Like the bits and pieces.
Jump into designing the teeth. Right. Yeah, right. I want to draw the teeth.
But first, do all the things everyone just said, right?
Yeah. Slow down. Think about your problem. Think about the context. Yes?
Well, question your assumptions because it's kind of put you in a box where you can just take and, this box. And
great. Yeah. It's amazing. So there's
assumptions
are really key. Yeah. The more you can challenge and question them, it's like a muscle. The more you do it, the better you get at it. And the better you get at it, it's awesome. There's a guy, Craig Launcher. He works at Stryker Medical as a designer. Him and his team will spend 2 days just writing assumptions at the start of a project. Now, Stryker Medical, if something goes wrong with their product, somebody's life's at risk. Okay? So they really need to dig deep into that. But what that does is that helps them to get to the right breakthroughs so they can really create amazing products to help save people's lives. So assumptions really can do an amazing thing. Yes? Yes. It's a group process, right? You can't do it by yourself, right? There's the theory of the lone star ranger, lone star designer. It's not really real. And there's a reason why I asked these guys, and thank you again for indulging me in having these little tables. I want you guys, designing collaborative is really important. Deb, give Deb a hand. Ready? Hey, actually, right? 1, 2, 3. That's for you, Deb. Thanks. So thank you all. I guess there will be a survey for feedback.
Yeah.
So thank you. I appreciate this. Feel free to. She has my contact information. Feel free to reach out to me if you want to learn more. I'll hang around for a while if you have any further questions.
1, 2, 3.
Nice.
Thank you.